My guest today is Brian. How you doing today, Brian?
Good. Can't complain, Keith.
Good to have you on. Looking forward
Thanks
to our
for
conversation.
Having me. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
So I'm going to give you a question to kind of get us warmed up here. So give me the best advice you've ever received.
Oh, that's a good one. I always seem to fall back on. So when we were in 2019, Rapunzel was fundraising for the company, and our lead investor at the time, we sat down with him, and his big piece of advice was that thinking is cheap. And he was like, look, you're really big on this company. You've been doing this for a couple of years. You're putting out fires every day. He's like, you've never really had the opportunity to take a step back and think. And he goes, before I give you, and we raised $3 million from him, he's like, before I give you all this money, it's like, you're going to take a couple months and think about it, because you can't think about it after you lose the money. And so we kind of, which was very astute, but we applied that a lot to like how we work on things, where it's like, try something out, or like do a test of a couple emails to people first, before kind of just going all in. And so it was, that's been, we've really tried to refine and apply that to as much of the company as we can.
I like that. That's good. And good sound advice.
Exactly. Well, and it was like, huh, I mean, I always got told, think before you act, think before you speak. I was like, thinking is cheap. That's a good way to frame it from a financial literacy standpoint. So it's good.
Yeah, look before you leap. Good. I like that.
Exactly.
So, Brian, who are some people in your life that maybe serve as inspiration for you? I always ask that question to my guests to really give them time to just maybe stop and thank the people that maybe they haven't thought about thanking before, who were integral parts of your life.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think my parents were a huge influence. I'm sure that's everyone's first answer, but I grew up, both my parents were investment bankers. So I grew up learning about finance all the time around the dinner table. And so I think seeing kind of the work ethic that they brought to their jobs really influenced me and kind of trying. And then a big thing my mom always had was like, you finish the assignment and then you put your name on it. She's like, you don't put your name on anything that you're not proud to have your name on. So I think kind of having that, it was the work ethic, but then also a passion and a love for what they do. My mom left investment banking and went and worked in education and trying to provide kind of quality education regardless of student zip code. And so I think those two passions, I mean, they really came together in founding Rapunzel, being a financial literacy tool for classrooms. It was kind of taking the conversations that I had the opportunity to be exposed to as a child and kind of at the dinner table, and making that experience more of the norm for students, I think.
That's great. I love that. Tell us something about yourself you love people to know about you.
Oh, that's tough. I mean, I think one of the more interesting things, so when we started Rapunzel, we did something pretty untraditional where neither my partner or I knew how to code, which was a pretty important piece of building an app. They don't have that in the books. They kind of think that's a prerequisite. But I think so. One of the things that I try to stress to people whenever we're on calls is they're kind of wondering, they talk to my partner and I, and they're like, well, who builds this? And so I actually discovered in kind of the first couple of years of starting Rapunzel that I love programming. And more importantly, and I think part of what really dictated the success that we've had is that it helps my brain shut off. So typically like post dinner is when all of the Rapunzel app is actually built and coded. And so, I mean, I've really found like a passion in that, but I think in other things, I mean, loving what people I love, I want them to know about me. I mean, I think that both my partner, it's like, I think we started Rapunzel with the idea of, hey, this is a great idea to get rich. Like, we're going to have an app, we're going to sell it, we're going to make a ton of money. And I think that it's been important to really stress to partners along the way that after spending so much time teaching in classrooms and working with kids, that I think the passion piece of it is really important. And I think beyond just people I love, anyone who's looking at starting a company or starting a organization, it's like, you can't just go into it for the profit incentive. There's got to be some passion behind what you're doing. Otherwise, I think it's really evident and there's like a lack of authenticity as you're building stuff.
So true. So tell us your personal story. I'm kind of curious how you got where you are.
Yeah, so like I said, I mean, both my parents were in finance. They were both Chicago natives, but I was born in London. They both took jobs working in finance sector in Europe. So I was born and raised, and then around 7 years old, moved back to Chicago. I was one of those kids that I felt like I had it all figured out at like 9 years old. I had a plan. If I want to do this in investment banking, I'm going to do this and work in private equity. I mean, I think by 10, I had till 35 mapped out, and none of the plan materialized. So I met my co-founder, Miles, freshman year of high school. We were like three lockers apart, and two of the only kids in our class that really were interested in investing and gravitated towards finance. And so we remained friends through high school. And then during college, Robinhood started gaining a ton of popularity. Saw a lot of our friends start to invest for the first time and not really know what they were doing. And so we took a step back and tried to figure out what were the ways that we enjoyed learning about investing, like what kind of ways could we use in today's day and age. And we arrived at the idea of Rapunzel, which is a platform that allows students to simulate $10,000 stock and crypto portfolios and then enter those portfolios into scholarship competitions. So the first one, we worked with about 2,000 students in Chicago. And then now, 5 years later, we have about 60, 70,000 students that participate in our scholarship competitions each school year. And Miles and I have kind of moved from spending a ton of time teaching in the classrooms to now working a lot more with school districts and other educators to kind of bring this to more schools and more neighborhoods across the country.
You're doing so. So tell us how you think financial education is going to change or evolve over the next 10 years.
I think fortunately we're starting to see that in this world that we say money makes the world go round, it seems like we finally flipped a light switch that we should teach kids about money, which is really beneficial. So I think we've seen a little more than half of states and more than half of students are required to take a financial literacy course before they graduate. And so I think that we're going to keep seeing that number grow until it becomes a graduation requirement for high schoolers. And it makes a lot of sense because we constantly say that reading, writing, and arithmetic are these core skills that you need in any profession. And I've yet to find the job that you don't have to pay income taxes. And so it's like if taxes are a part of life that everyone's going to kind of have to deal with, it's like I think we should be teaching our kids about kind of how to pay them. Similarly, I think there's over 50% of U.S. adults carry credit card debt over each month. And so I think trying to – these are huge costs like sucks that are taking away from people who don't get exposed to the financial literacy training that everyone should have access to. And so I think as we start seeing kind of rectifying some of those issues, what we're hoping to see is that a lot less predatory financial institutions going after low income communities and kind of communities having more a wherewithal and understanding. But then also, I think by providing more financial literacy or understanding career paths in finance, it's not all about that some people don't understand budgeting. There's also the problem of the equation that not enough money is coming in to actually build savings. And so I think by kind of highlighting that some of the most expensive real estate in cities is big bank buildings. So how do the banks have so much money to own all of these buildings? I think that those careers historically having gone to white males, that there's just a lack of access to capital. So I think that as financial education increases, I think a greater swath of the population is going to have access to that capital, which would be really powerful.
You talk about financial education, kind of explain for those who may not be totally aware of what you mean by that. Define that for us.
Yeah. So financial education covers a lot. And so I think the easiest way to think about it is that it's really teaching you about money. So what we typically have is a lot of people think of financial literacy from a saving and budgeting standpoint, but it goes a lot further than that. I mean, financial literacy is how you manage debt and how you manage credit cards or purchasing your first home, all the way into just figuring out if college is right for you after high school. I mean, it's really, really not fair how this country kind of makes it so that college is a prerequisite and you have to go into debt if your parents can't afford to pay for it for you. And I think that a lot of students would benefit from kind of looking at the cost analysis of what do I want to do in life and do I need a college degree for it? Do I need to borrow $200,000, $300,000 just to kind of enter the workforce? And so all of that kind of gets factored into financial literacy, the idea of investing or growing your money. And so these are really important things, and they're important for kind of planning for retirement or kind of having a family sustaining career. And so it's not necessarily that financial literacy ties to just working in finance. It's kind of a skill that everyone needs.
I'm thinking of a recent situation where I saw all of a sudden GameStop really started shooting up. It was a company that was kind of on its last leg, and a bunch of investors came in and invested money in it. So kind of walk our audience through, how do you teach people to find good investments, especially young people you're working with? And what should they be looking for if they're talking about investing?
Yeah. So, I mean, the big thing that we try to push kids towards is that stock picking is really, really hard. Even like the top investors in the world, they keep running these studies, and it's unbelievable that it's like, if you were one of the top 100 hedge funds in the world last year, that has absolutely no predictive value of if you're going to be one of the top hedge funds this year. And it's kind of unbelievable when you think of like Patrick Mahomes throws a bunch of touchdowns last year. It's like, okay, he's by and large is going to be a great quarterback this year too. And then when you look at the superstars of finance, it's like year to year, they aren't able to replicate a lot of their results. So what we try and teach kind of the ordinary investor is that you don't need to pick the next Facebook or to be a successful investor. And so we really push this idea of buying the market, which is essentially like investing in an ETF that covers maybe like the 500 largest companies in the US. And so instead of having to understand the specifics of how a company performs and what makes the stock go up, you're more so just betting that the global economy is going to grow and that people are going to consume more next year than they consumed this year. And historically, that's been a bet that it's not very exciting. It's definitely not like the fun you see in Wall Street, Money Never Sleeps or Wolf of Wall Street, but it is the way that people are amassing massive amounts of wealth. Is that I think it's a Warren Buffett quote that it's like investing should be as boring as watching paint dry. And so I think, unfortunately, since we haven't been teaching that effectively enough, that when we saw things like GameStop or AMC and that whole meme stop craze, I think it was really apparent that just because we don't teach people about investing doesn't mean they're not going to try and figure it out themselves. And so what we found is then you get Reddit boards teaching people about the keys to investing. And I had an uncle who called me and was like, I'm buying all this GameStop because I'm going to really stick it to Citadel and Ken Griffin. And I was like, Ken Griffin, and this was like whatever the same week, I was like, Ken Griffin just bought a $250 million house in London. I'm like, you're not sticking it to him, I promise. So trying to like, I agree that there's outsized compensation amongst Wall Street executives and there's things that need to be evaluated. But if you're going to try to stick it to them, you don't want to do that in financial markets. They have a lot more money. They got a lot more people. I remember a story. A guy who supported Rapunzel early on was talking about, and he used the example of Lululemon. And he's like, look, you love their leggings. You think, okay, Lululemon's going to grow. They're doing really great this year. I hear about it from my friends. And he goes, Goldman Sachs is also looking at Lululemon, except they hire someone to sit outside every store in the US and count the number of bags that leave. And they use that to predict how Lululemon sales are going to be. It's like, and so his big thing was like, how do you think you're going to beat hundreds of people across the country counting every bag because you have a hunch? And so it was really trying to hammer down that, like, these firms are spending a lot of money and placing a lot bigger trades. So trying to focus, yeah, on just like capturing the whole economy's growth is a much more solid bet.
So kind of walk me through what a typical course looks like that you're trying to help teach education for young people.
Yeah. So, I mean, we really try to emphasize like student agency. So while there's full modules where teachers have a presentation, they have in-class activities and whatnot for the students, one of the core pieces is that we integrate students' simulated portfolios into the classroom. So rather than just learning about, oh, diversification is important, don't put all your eggs in one basket, kids get to actually put that into practice. So it's kind of, you learn about diversification, then you look at your own portfolio and it's figuring out that maybe instead of investing all my money in Apple, I should have also been buying Samsung and Facebook, but then maybe not just owning technology companies. So it's letting students kind of have that sense of agency of building a portfolio and building ownership over it. And one of the phenomenal outcomes is that you will deal with adversity. We've yet to find a student that picks 20 stocks and all 20 stocks go up. And so it's kind of letting students make mistakes in a risk-free way has been, we always just try to tell the kids, it's like, look, it's better to lose money now than to lose money with your real money once you graduate. So that's kind of been a really integral part of kind of that teaching in the classroom.
Neat. So I hear you earned $500,000 grant from Yaz Foundation. Tell us more about that program.
Yeah, so the Yaz Foundation, I mean, it opened an incredible number of doors. So it was about a year ago that we, maybe a little longer than a year, that we applied. And so the Yaz Foundation's all about supporting education providers that are sustainable, transformational, outstanding, and permissionless. And the program was really born out of COVID when there were when there was support for first responders in hospitals and for firemen. And then it was looking at, we have these educators who were asking to come back in person while a lot of the world was still closed down. And how are we supporting those educators? And so this Yaz Prize was really designed to kind of find exceptional education models, whether for-profit or nonprofit, and try to give them kind of the opportunity to scale, whether that be into a different state or, for the sake of Rapunzel, it was kind of growing nationally and meeting this demand of financial literacy in schools across the country. And it's just been an unbelievable, I was helping judge their 2023 applications earlier today, and they have about 5,000 applications of education groups, like charter schools, public schools, homeschools, everyone's kind of applying. And so it's just really cool to see the number of organizations that are trying to improve education outcomes and also the community they've built. So we received $500,000 and were named a finalist in December. And they kept telling us when we won the prize, like, oh, the community is even more powerful. And I'll be the first to admit, I'm like, yeah, I've never seen a $500,000 check. I was like, let's see that part first, and then we'll talk about the community. But I mean, it truly was that, I mean, we sat down with Governor of Oklahoma, Governor of Iowa. We've kind of been invited to a big educator symposium out in Fargo, North Dakota. And then we got to meet a ton of legislators in DC and talking about all these different education models that we have. So the access that they've been able to provide, I mean, I think it's gotten Rapunzel into close to another 100 schools in the past 6-7 months. So they keep us busy. We're flying around a lot, but it's all kind of, it's been an unbelievable opening doors for starting an organization in Chicago and really working locally to then kind of now have this national scale at our fingertips. It's been really cool.
Great. So We talked about all the positives. I can see your energy. So, but what are some of the challenges Rapunzel is facing going moving forward?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a long list. I think the biggest challenge that it's not just specific to Rapunzel that we've learned is that from like all of the venture capital funding that's out there, about 90% of venture capitalists don't enjoy or don't ever support education solutions. And so it's been a challenge, and that's where a lot of our funding has come from, private individuals more so than institutional. But I think it's a bigger challenge than just one for Rapunzel, is that we kind of are starting to see this huge learning gap that we had emerge from COVID. And I mean, in Chicago, it's something like 25% of graduating high school students are able to read at grade level. And the challenge is that if there isn't the capital to come in to support innovation and to support new ways to teach, I don't know how we're going to change some of these really scary statistics. And I mean, it's one of the other groups that was a Yas Prize finalist said it best when they're like, the media wants to talk about banning books. It's like, if 3/4 of kids can't read, every book is banned. And so I think that, and similarly, it took us 6 years now to get approved to have our financial literacy solution in Chicago public schools, which, I mean, there were other avenues for us and we were able to grow. But I think that if we're not trying to innovate faster than, oh, every 5-6 years, we'll evaluate new ideas. I think what we're kind of seeing the results of it across kind of these educational outcomes. And so I think that's a huge challenge. And I think it's going to translate. It translates into our other challenges, just trying to grow the team and trying to find, it's the best way to say it, affordable individuals to join the team that are kind of in my partner and my range who don't have 15, 20 years experience doing this. I think that there's turning into a pretty kind of big talent drought where, again, with like the financial literacy of should you go to college, I think that a lot of college degrees aren't really educating students for what they need in the workforce. And it started with us reading articles about that. And now as we're kind of trying to hire and grow the team, I think we're experiencing that from the other side of it.
If you had one piece of advice for someone who's just starting to kind of get their hand on this, what would that be?
I think whether it's starting a business or trying to get started with the investing side of it, it's just really get started. Without question, I think that we all learn best by doing. And I mean, I had to learn all the countries and capitals in high school. And I can still remember that I didn't get Honduras and Tegucigalpa right. And that's the one that sticks out. I did exceptionally well on that test. It might've been one of my best tests ever. And it was like, that was the one where it was like, I'll never forget it. So I think that making mistakes in this like risk-free environment is really important. And then on the side of starting a business, I mean, I was the kid with the plan, go to work in investment banking, go to grad school. And I had that all mapped out. And I think I learned more in the first year of working on Rapunzel than I could have learned in 3 years at grad school. So I think just really putting yourself out there and going for it, I think is probably the best piece of advice I have for at least younger professionals kind of starting out.
I can really see your passion for this. So what drives your passion for what you're doing?
I mean, I think the biggest thing was, so when I met my partner Miles freshman year, partner Miles is Black from the South Side of Chicago. And whenever we would talk to people about our investing, it was always like, wow, you're so articulate. That's so impressive that you understand this. And it was all these like the microaggressions that he's kind of learned to just brush off, but it always just, it never sat right with either of us that it was like, why is Miles the exception? Why is it that I grew up on north side of Chicago and all of my friends knew about stock market investing? So it was kind of trying to address this idea that your zip code determines your outcomes in life, and trying to kind of make sure that we have like the greatest wealth engine that we've ever conceived of in kind of the stock market. And it's just such an it's the proof is in the pudding, where it's like, if we don't teach people, they don't have the access to it. And then you see this wealth gap just continuing to grow. And I think it's not even about kind of economically empowering communities. It's that the people who are making the decisions that run the world are basing their decisions based off money or based off stock prices. And so in order to really be an informed citizen, I think you need to understand money. And I think that a lot of the divisions that we're seeing in our country or around the world, it's a lot of having some low-income groups hate other low-income groups. And I think if everyone understood financial literacy a little more, they might realize that the system isn't, they're not the ones taking the other's lunch. And so I think that kind of having that education would help kind of level the playing field on that perspective too.
So I'm curious, what's next for Rapunzel, the next season?
So next season, I mean, we're still growing. So our last school year, we expanded our national high school scholarship to include middle school students. This upcoming school year, we're launching a educator portal. So it has a full financial literacy curriculum for instructors to bring into the classroom. And then we're also doing a national HBCU competition starting in September. So my partner Miles and I are renting a van, and we'll be visiting about 45 HBCUs from September to November. We've done this once before, sleeping in Red Roof Inns last school year. It's not a favorite part of our jobs, I will say that. But it's always fun being on campus. You get to interact with students. And I think it's been really fun for us as we've kind of grown the program, that most of the times you have your developers are sitting in an office, they're building the app. Maybe you have other people going out working with the students. But for me personally, to be able to speak to the students, have the student go, well, where do I do this, is phenomenal, because I get to go home, I have dinner, and then it's like, okay, we're going to make that button clearer so that I don't have to answer that question. So it's constantly like iterating on almost a daily basis to just answer fewer questions, I guess.
Well, I went to an HBC, so I appreciate what you're doing.
Okay, which school?
Southern University in Baton Rouge.
Okay. We're going down. I forget which week, but in October, yeah, we're going down to Louisiana for the week. Yeah. Going to Xavier, Dillard.
So you got Baton Rouge, you got Grambling down there, so yeah.
Yeah. Awesome.
So Miles, I like to ask my guests this question. What do you want your legacy to be?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if I've thought too much about a legacy. I mean, I think that right now you have about 26-27% of US adults have some form of investment account. I'd love to play a role in doubling that figure. So I think just trying to improve equitable access to financial markets. I think we also do a lot of summer programs that are really trying to address the lack of representation in financial services. So with less than 1% of C-suites of financial firms having an individual of color or even a woman on the board, I think that trying to address some of that representation, and just to have known that I played a part in kind of making the world of finance more accessible, I think that would be a good start, at least for a legacy.
Love that. I am curious. I lived in Chicago for 12 years. So how in the world does a Cub fan and a Sox fan work together?
You know, I don't know either. But I will say that after college, I ended up moving to like Printers Row, South Loop in Chicago. And all I did was go to Sox games, because it was like the pricing of tickets, the ease of getting in there. I'm like, Wrigley Field's like, it's a nightmare. So I think my partner's got it best. He's like, I don't root against Chicago teams. Now, we did go to a Cubs Sox game, and I don't know how much that held true, but I think we've both always just been really positive on Chicago, and kind of just trying to carry that piece of it through. That I don't know. There's definitely parts of Wrigley where he's like, I don't need this, and there's parts of going to the U.S. Cellular where I'm like, yeah, this isn't for me. But no, it's been. We didn't confront it in high school. In high school, we didn't talk baseball. We managed to do that as we've matured.
There you go. So is there anything I haven't asked you that I should have asked you?
I don't think so. I mean, I think that really covered it. I mean, the biggest thing that we're kind of looking at is that now we're finally appreciating that we got to teach kids about money. And so I think it's just been really exciting to, whenever you start a company, it's like the first 3 or 4 years, you got a bunch of people wondering like, wait, what does this do exactly? And you're kind of wondering in your head, like, I don't know, does it do what you want it to do? So it's been really encouraging this past year that whenever we're talking to people, they're like, oh, this is great. This is what I've been looking for. So it's just been good to not feel crazy, I think.
Well, Brian, this is great. So where can people find your website and find Rapunzel? And where can they connect with you on social media?
So if they want to check out Rapunzel, it's rapunzelinvestments.com. It's Rapunzel without an E, and because you have to drop an E as a tech company. And so that's usually the best. If you want to create an account and kind of get started simulating a portfolio, you just go to rapunzel.app or search it in the App Store or the Google Play Store. And then for following us, I mean, Twitter's probably the best. And it's just Rapunzel_invest.
Is it still Twitter or is it X now? See, I can't tell if you can still tweet.
Yeah.
Or are you Xing now? I don't know what you're doing. If you're not tweeting, are you Xing? I don't know what that is.
Right. I'll have to see. Zetum or something.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, Brian, thanks so much for taking the time and blessings on what you do, because I know, especially in Chicago, I live there. If you can really make a difference in young people's lives there about teaching them how to invest and really giving them a hope for the future, you're really accomplishing a lot, because that's a underserved area in terms of the potential that's there, but also the depth of the problem that's also there. So I commend you for investing in the lives of young people.
Absolutely. No, just trying to play our part.
Well, thanks, Brian. Have a great one.
Absolutely. Thank you, Keith. Have a good one.